It's a great time to check in here and give a report, an update. The storm has come in, the deluge has been on and off here. And I'm feeling like I haven't kind of gotten anywhere. Like, where's the results? Well, so I was starting to get kind of frustrated, but then I reminded myself, hey, wait a minute. Just a little while ago, I've been able to look at the very root of our entire problem, the very heart of the fear, so of course I'm going to take a little while to get adjusted to that and settle into it. This is the continuity fear, the backlash. So, and then I said, oh, thank you for going this far. Thank you. I talked to the continuity concerns. And thank you for going this far. It's really great. And so I started putting a positive spin on it. This is great. Everything's fine. When you have a continuity fear backlash, what happens is you start worrying about what people are going to say. Like when you set down your, you know, attempt to disempower yourself. What are all the questions they're going to pester you with, and you feel like you're crushed by all this pressure. Because you see the freedom, you realize, wow, it's there, but you backed away from it. And so now you're not really there, and you're wondering about, when I get there, how am I going to deal with how I feel right now, which is all uncertain, right? Uncertain. So you can't really deal with uncertainty when you're uncertain. So even though we may have seen freedom from uncertainty, we've seen certainty, but we backed away from it a little bit. So now we're uncertain. So the whole uncertainty of the world seems to be too much for us. And we say, well, I can't go any further. So we have to recognize what's going on and drop all the questioning, the worries and concerns, and just say, no, this is just, I'm in a period of uncertainty because of a familiarity problem. And don't get depressed, don't struggle. I say don't struggle with the struggle. So when this uncertainty arises out of a lack of familiarity, sort of back into uncertainty, don't struggle with that. Just say, okay, the reason I backed into uncertainty is because I glimpsed certainty. And so that means I'm making great progress here. So celebrate the progress and feel good about it. Say, I feel great about this. No problem. This is great. This is the secret of the path. This is the secret. Don't struggle with the struggle. Celebrate the struggle and say, great. I temporarily am feeling sort of uncertain because I glimpsed certainty and it kind of shocked me. Like this morning, I had this brief glimpse of like this atmosphere that was like perfect. This balmy, beautiful, perfect atmosphere. And it was just like the rain, the gloom, it all like parted like this and just disappeared. Just disappeared. Like a fade, like a fade between two scenes in a video. It just faded, and here was this beautiful, perfect, balmy atmosphere. It's just, and then I saw it and I said, wow. And then it gradually faded because I, you know, a little bit of familiarity fear taking place. So now the clouds are back, but I realized that it can be set down that quickly. All our problems can just fade away in just a moment like that. All of our concern, all of our uncertainty can just fade away. What are we uncertain about? We're uncertain about reality, right? We're uncertain about reality, actually. And we're worried that, when we see it, we think, well, how can it stay that way? How can it stay? And it's always that way. It can't be changed. It's just that we're trying to disempower it. So we're believing in this dream of disempowerment. But the dream of disempowerment does not disempower reality at all. hanging out here. So the path takes patience. It's frustrating. You keep getting glimpses, but that helps. The glimpses help, but they don't seem to stay. They think, where did it go? Well, we retreated is what happened. So the more you can not struggle, keep your mind quiet and poised, the sooner the glimpses will return. So I'm having many glimpses every day, actually, in many ways now. But they don't remain, they're still ephemeral, somewhat ephemeral. But we have to realize it's the continuity fear, the lack of familiarity, which frightens us. All questions will eventually just melt away in the realization of, I was just trying to disempower myself. That's all that I was trying to do. And it didn't work. Thankfully, it didn't work. And God did not create me with the function of trying to disempower myself. I invented that. I imagined it. But that's what I wanted to try to overcome the will of God, but just on a whim. This is my function. This is the function God gave me. But it's not true. It's merely a whimsical idea of experiencing you wanted to have. But we're free to experience anything at all out of pure potentiality. More storms are on the way in California. After this one passes, another one, and then another one. This is great. It's drought busters here. This is what we've been praying for. This is just terrific. So nobody's complaining. We're all very happy. There again, in what I saw this morning, in this beautiful land and atmosphere, there's no concerns about drought or flooding or anything like that. It's just, wow. So when you reach the deeper recognitions and clarities, there's bound to be some backlash, but when you go at it progressively, bit by bit by bit, it's not so bad. Not so bad at all. Just it's the same as any other backlash I've ever experienced. But if you try to force yourself into that deeper clarity through the use of drugs, through various means that people try to use, to try to be, you know, spiritual show-offs, essentially, there's big problems then. Big problems. You end up, the reaction to perfection, the unfamiliarity ends up causing a very strong retreat into some sort of defensive shell, actually. Into some sort of defensive shell. And then people hold on to that shell at all costs. Because they think, you know, they feel this is what's protecting me from perfection. Yeah, it's bad. Of course it is. Absolutely it is. That's what I'm here to help with. Go the safe way. Go the safe way. That is why I'm saying that a overall monastic, theocratic, monastic, religious culture is the safe way to do it. When that drops away, people still have this traction, you know, to what they are, what we all are, and perfection. And so what happens is they'll try to sort of shock themselves into it. And then they have a reaction formation from this, and then this throws them into this sort of neurotic defensiveness in some way, to use psychoanalytic terms. And they get fixated. So that's not the safe way. It's not the way to do it. It's not the way to do it. And actually, the cleverness of our defenses actually promoting this, trying to shock yourself into it, because they know, this knows, is going to produce this reaction formation of defensiveness, which can then be easily manipulated and be a source of trying to fix illusions, trying to make them real, trying to be happy with illusions, trying to satisfy greed and vanity. So it creates an overall very negative entropic society and culture, very much so. The cosmic corporate cabal bringing its princess culture, princess entitlement culture here, causes people to feel that they need to serve the vanity of the goddess here, and meaning try to make everything here in this world so neat and precise and clean and maintain everything perfectly, and all, you know, you get trapped into this materialism is what happens. Whereas a theocratic monastic culture that puts lifelong practice as the culture doesn't get trapped into that materiality, doesn't get trapped in it. It's not serving vanity. It's not serving vanity. So whereas this global culture now is serving vanity, that's what this culture does. It serves vanity. Even getting rid of the vanity is too shocking. So the problem is it goes from shock to shock to shock, overcompensation, reaction formations, defensiveness, back and forth. This is the cycles of existence. The only way out of that is to take the safe way, which is like I say, a theocratic, religious, monastic culture, which is a culture of practice and meditation, contemplation, and more than that, lifetime of effort. Everybody, that's what everybody does, along with whatever tasks and lifestyle they have. Everyone is a practitioner, practicing quiet mind and working through this continuity fear, working through this familiarity problem. This is the safe way. This is the safe way. And then you don't have these wild swings that constitute existence. Don't have those. You don't swing from heroin to villainous like that, you know. And back in just these wild, you know, bipolar. Existence is bipolar. Existence is bipolar, very much so. You go through a period of vanities, and you have a bonfire of the vanities, thank you, Tom Wolf. And you go into some asceticism, you know. And this is what Buddha pointed out. He says, no, the middle path, the safe way, this is what all wise ones point out, is to prevent this constant chaotic back and forthness of existence, from indulgence to severe self-abnegation and all this stuff. That's not the way. That's not the way. The way is daily commitment and practice, realizing it's going to go fairly slow for you because of this familiarity problem, because you're afraid of perfection. We're afraid of perfection. We're afraid to realize that, but we've never disempowered ourselves in the slightest bit. So this is what works. The other stuff doesn't work. It doesn't work. existence is like it becomes then a roller coaster, up and down and around, and it's just like, and after a while, I say, "Get me off of this, get me off of this. This is terrible." And yet we don't know how to get off of it. And the answer is very simple: daily commitment. Commit your day to make progress, spiritual progress, knowing that with that comes two steps forward, one step back. That's how it goes. So when everyone understands this, then the goals are realistic. Here in this world, we have such unrealistic goals. It's pathetic. We keep thinking that if you're on a spiritual path, well, you should be able to just go see some guru and that's it. You're done. Fast food. You're supposed to just do it right now. Because why do we think that? Because we got so much other stuff we got to do. We got to fix the world. I mean, we can't spend time sitting here silently. I mean, there's so many problems in the world. Keep in mind that these problems are all of them are our attempt to disempower ourselves. And we're terrified to be without these problems. So whatever problems we fix, we're sure to generate other problems. It's an endless cycle that way. Until we overcome, recognize there's no cause for fear. There's no causation of fear. Until we realize that, we'll keep causing these problems. And the reason why people beg to be freed of problems here in this world is not because they want to be perfect, realize their perfection. It's because they're very afraid that they might start on the spiritual path because of their problems. And that frightens them. So they say, please, help me with my problems because I'm feeling very much like I want to drop existence because it's so terrible. And if I do that, I'll be annihilated, is what they think. So please make existence look better to me. And of course, we have to say, no, that's not the right way. Use your problems as motivation to get you going on saying, you know what? Let's listen to the wise and say that all of this fear, all of this is uncaused. Meaning, this isn't, reality is not causing this, not specifying it at all. And the fear of annihilation is no cause for it. It's just a trick we're playing on ourselves. It's a motivational trick we're playing on ourselves. We thought that if we could frighten ourselves by claiming that if we didn't succeed at annihilating God, God was going to annihilate us. And so this is just a trick we use, a motivational trick. And now we've gotten trapped. We feel we're trapped in this trick. We've believed it. Of course, belief systems are just belief systems. So, of course, a belief system is going to be whatever it is that we make of it. But we don't have to have that belief system. We can just exchange the belief system. And that is, God is not going to annihilate us at all. We were not created with the function of trying to disempower ourselves and God. Now, just talking at this level is something just isn't done in this world, really. So that's why I'm experiencing a backlash. It's frustrating. Because I know that I could communicate, you know, much better. But just the fear of just saying this, you know, it's too close to home for most people. Too close to home. They want to figure out, how can we be happy with our problems? They don't want to get rid of the problems. They want to be happy with their problems. Because problems to them symbolize that they're working on disempowerment, which means to them that God will not annihilate them because they can point to these problems. Look, God, look at all these problems I'm working on. I'm trying to disempower myself. Don't worry, we're working on it. look at how I'm being crushed by all these problems. Ease up a little bit on all my problems. I'm feeling, you know, it's like it might be a little too much. As if somehow God's causing these problems. God is not causing any problems. How can God ease up on your problems? God's not causing them. We're the ones that are causing them. And again, in explaining all this, you can see it, but then we say, well, wait a minute. That means I can drop all my problems and realize I'm perfect. And they can do it this instant. Uh-oh, not ready for that. As they're back into defensiveness. And then searching for others who have the same defensiveness and forming a little group, you know, of equal defense, like like-minded defensiveness. And claiming that this is it. Anyone else who's not says differently, they're dangerous. And it goes on and on and on like this. If we think we're going to find world peace, you know, just look at this dynamic that we have that is inherently generating severe defensiveness and fear that anyone who doesn't think like they do is a dangerous enemy. This is the world. This is this terrible scenario that we find ourselves in, this terrible dream, a nightmare, actually. And we're all just trying to get by, hopefully avoiding the worst of it. Like a huge storm coming, you say, well, I hope it's the eye of the hurricane, I hope it don't, you know, doesn't go right, you know, right through this area. Maybe it can miss this area, hopefully. Too bad it hits the others, but we don't want to hit us. So again, the best that most people feel about the world is they just hope they can avoid the worst of it. You know, I hope I avoid the, you know, terrible illness when I get older. You know, I hope my sickness and death is not, you know, hideous. This is what's on our mind, of course. And they pray to God, God, just please don't let my illness, sickness be too bad. Don't let my disempowerment be too painful. I'm trying to do what you ask, but it's so difficult. This is not praying to God at all. I mean, it's not. It's praying to ourselves, to our ego. We are God, but not the prime creator. We did not establish reality the way that it is. We are the reality as it is established, but we didn't establish it. So what we find is, in speaking of this, is inner turmoil, upset. Absolutely, of course. But what we want to do is not retreat into defensiveness. So we just stay with it peacefully, calmly, and let it evaporate without getting into a bunch of questions or statements. This is how we avoid reaction formation. Reacting and then forming a defense against ever going near there again. That's why you cannot take the path from the standpoint of humanistic analysis. That's why psychotherapy doesn't really work in depth at all, because it's not based on genuine wisdom and clarity as far as what we are spiritually. So at some point you're going to have a reaction formation, and then where everyone sort of agrees that but this is far enough, as it lets you have. So you sort of a consensual agreement in the world that this is far enough. Let's call it good. Let's call this reality. Let's call this a happy, adjusted life. Let's not go any further. This is what you get in the world. Now, when we run into this in the world, those who really want liberation, salvation, so there's agreed upon formation, defensive formation, reaction formation, a consensual one. And so as you want to set down disempowerment, you feel like somehow you have to do it and be happy within the limits of this reaction formation, a consensual reaction formation. You can't go any further. If I was going further, so then people get frustrated. They get frustrated. They don't see any way, and that's when they get into drugs. They get into various ways to try to overstimulate themselves, try to break down the reaction formation somehow, you know, like that. And they don't do it the safe way. They don't do it the safe way because they just, let's face it, in our culture, what avenues do we have? I didn't find any avenues except actually Saved by a Course in Miracles. Without that, I would have been a complete mess and probably wouldn't be here. No way. I couldn't find a way. You know, we were searching, because we were stuck in this terrible reaction formation. And we started hearing reports of the Tibetan Buddhism and various Eastern Advaita Vedanta. But it was so unfocused at that time that we couldn't make heads or tails. It was not, you know, it didn't seem like a way past it at all. Just even added more pressure and confusion. But fortunately, I was able to, of course, the miracles came into the world, which provided a pathway from where we were at, which is in the psychoanalytic mode, thinking that would take us as far as we could go, and then this reaction formation from that ineffective approach, being stuck in that. So, of course, the miracles use psychoanalytic terminology to some extent, starting out, and gradually it's like a bridge. It's like a bridge that took us further into a safe practice, which is what I've been doing now for a long time. The safe way, it's called. Where every day, more and more familiarity, deeper and deeper familiarity, every day, deeper and deeper familiarity, moving at one's comfort zone, one's familiarity, ever closer to setting down the attempt to disempower ourselves. It's just setting that down, it's changing. Or not trying to disempower ourselves. That's the safe way. And then once I found the safe way, I just used it. And all the other stuff, forget it. Yeah, forget it. Don't need that stuff. And I know a lot of other people are still trying to stimulate themselves past delusion, and this is something that, this is why we do it in all sorts of various ways, is we're trying to break down this seemingly intractable barrier. Well, we don't understand that it's a barrier because of reacting to our perfection that we are, and we're saying, that's too good, I'm scared of that. So we have to approach it very carefully. And a lot of people got into various teachings, et cetera, that tried to push it too much, being the Westward in a big hurry, and that those also became reaction formations. A lot of religious teaching, spiritual teaching, is stuck in reaction formation. Fortunately, I was able to sidestep most of that, really, gradually sidestep it all. Because keep in mind that some of these traditions, come like Tibetan Buddhism, comes from a monastic, religious, theocratic, monastic culture of, you know, long duration. It's been going on for, almost 1,500 years there, something like long duration. And so it's just assumed, you know, there's so many assumptions, cultural assumptions there, that we don't realize, that it's just assumed that this is a lifelong commitment. But more than that, and we're in such a hurry that we aren't able to really thrive there and we end up making these reaction formations. So it's generally better to work within your own culture and find a way within your own culture. Unfortunately, we have A Course in Miracles, which is set in a Western Judeo-Christian culture that allows us, it's a fit, it's designed for that. It's self-study, which is something that we're used to a lot. Studying, reading books, trying thinking, is designed for self-study. You go at your own pace. It's a self-study, self-paced way. Of course, there's always people offering instant results, you know, pop spirituality. And we keep thinking, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with me? How come I can't just go see the teacher and get instant transference there, and, you know, but but it doesn't work that way. But having to, you know, desperately work to make money to survive in this culture, people say, I don't have any time. But if you really look at your life, you can make time. You can structure your life in a more disciplined way. And make time. Like, for instance, what are you doing between 9 and 11 o'clock at night, for instance? Why not spend 2 hours there? Right? Or when you're commuting, or you're listening to the radio, what are you doing? Why not spend time in allowing this stream of consciousness and awareness there? What, you can do that and drive at the same time, for sure. Absolutely. On weekends, what are you doing on weekends? Why not use your weekends, dedicate the weekends to your own spiritual retreat? Every weekend's a spiritual retreat for you. See, all this stuff can be done. So, it's the United States, the Western world, is not going to be a theocratic, monastic culture. It's not going to be that. So we have to take it upon ourselves, discipline ourselves, to use our time in that way, and have our own little monastic life, so to speak, religious monastic life of spiritual retreats. Every weekend, it's dedicated to spiritual retreat. Now, this is not what cosmic corporate culture wants, actually. It's important to point out that the culture we have in this world is now a cosmic culture. It's a cosmic corporate culture that we have. CCC. P. CCCP. Cosmic culture. Cosmic corporate culture people. That's what we are. CCCP. And that tells you to avoid monastic life. Avoid, like, the plague. For them, it's the plague. It's kryptonite. For them, it's kryptonite. So, of course, they're going to defend against that. Because what they're saying is, we can be happy with our problems. We can be happy with our problems. Let's not solve them too fast, you know. We got a lot of problems there. We can be happy being problem solvers, they're saying. Yeah. Your happiness is in problem solving. Well, in order to solve problems, you have to have problems, right? So if your identity is that of a problem solver, you must therefore have problems, right? And if you don't, you think you're going to be annihilated. So of course you're going to keep generating problems. Speaking of that, here's a perfect example of this. There's so many examples. Just here in the Silicon Valley, there's a big article in the front page of the newspaper today. I noticed it when I picked up the newspaper. And basically, what it's saying, they're paying hackers now to point out the bugs in all these big tech companies. They're paying hackers. The problem is that the criminals are paying hackers more to point out the bugs to them. So there's this big war going on now between the tech companies. Who's going to pay the highest to these hackers. And one of the tech execs says, we're in this terrible, terrible cycle, spiral, that where it's getting worse and worse and worse, and we can't keep up with it. It's just, it's a horrible situation. In other words, we have severe problems down the road with hackers, because we can't, the criminals are paying the hackers more. And they're finding out, then the hackers tell them, here's the bug that I found. See, hackers are looking for ways in to hack through systems. They then sell that information to criminals. And so they're saying now that tech companies have to greatly increase the amount of money they're paying to hackers. It's essentially blackmail, isn't it? Paying to hackers. Nor so the hackers will share the information with them and not with the criminals. Of course, what keeps the hackers from sharing the information with both sides and getting money from both sides? So here we are, we think we're developing this wonderful world, but what the tech people are saying is no, we're developing this massive criminal world where it pays to, you know, crime pays. And they say that our information is less and less secure. We're putting all our identity and information, what we are, in our bank, everything, and trusting in the security of all the cyber systems, and yet they're becoming more and more vulnerable to being hacked into criminals, you know. So this whole cosmic corporate culture is designed, actually, to keep us ceaselessly dogged by problems. Dogged by problems. I saw a guy in a store with a t-shirt that says, I walk with him wherever I go, I feel safe, or something. I said, wow, a really religious guy. At the bottom says, I walk with dog. I thought I was going to say God, and I said, dog, I walk with dog. They're like, so this is, you know, the dog is like, you know, looking for problems. There's a problem, there's a problem, there's a problem. And so people here are walking with dog, which is problems. And the whole notion that somehow we really want to be free of problems is a delusion. What we're seeking here is more and more problems. We're terrified that we might be without problems and then recognize our perfection. So this world actually was getting too close to dropping its problems, and so the world called in this corporate, cosmic corporate culture, and said, help, 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 we need help. And they said, don't worry, we have the answers, we can solve your problem. And the problem was we didn't have enough problems. So they've brought in just a massive host of problems, as I've been pointing out my entire life. I said, hey folks, this isn't getting better, it's getting worse. The people said, no, this is the answer we've been looking for. So again, the problem that this world is afraid of is that it's going to lose its problems. This is what we really are frightened of. So we call in greater and greater problems. It's like in relationships, people realize, wow, we're here for one another in order to create problems for one another. And when things start getting too good, we get all jittery. And we start drawing, we're calling friends, hey friends, help, help, help. And we're feeling like, you know, like we don't have enough problems in our lives. And we might start thinking about, hey, I don't need problems at all. Whoa, hey, so what are friends for except to create problems and drama for us, right? This is the situation. And just recognizing it helps dissipate. Just recognize it. With humor. Not contrived humor, but recognizing it, wow. Look what I've been doing to myself. Isn't that funny that this is what it is? I thought that I'm trying to get rid of problems, and now I see that's the last thing we want. We want more problems, just different kinds, you know, because we're used to solving these other problems. Let's get a bunch of problems that we're not used to solving. That will really focus our attention on it. And we can point out to God, see, God, I'm not slacking. I'm still trying to disempower myself. I just haven't quite gotten there yet. It's just steady now. The heavy stuff seems to have passed by. That's what they said. There'd be a band of real heavy rain. Very soggy day. Very soggy day. Okay, well, I have to do some errands at some point. But you see, in the middle of the day, we can take time to go over the truth again and again. Hear it again. What's the secret? Hear the truth over and over and over again. That's the secret. Hear the truth over and over and over and over and over again. You see, the whole teaching in the world of the secret and all this affirmation stuff, I think Jesus has pointed out that this is, be careful about this. Because it's saying, I have a problem, I have a need, and I can figure a way to fulfill that need. But the truth is that we don't have any problems, we don't have any needs at all. Everything is God. Everything is free. This instant, everything. I'm spirit, I'm not a body. I don't have needs, really. This is realization. So all this stuff about affirmation and attraction, law of attraction, I can attract what I want to do. That's not it. That's dualistic. This is sort of maybe the modern religion that people are promoting. The fact is, this tree here, this place here, this is everything. It's pure potential. Pure potential is everywhere. That's all there is pure potential and the play with pure potential. But in the playing with pure potential is still present. It doesn't disappear. You see, even though we have all these forms, we think that somehow we've extracted these from pure potential. That is not true. Just like a wave is not extracted from the ocean. The ocean symbolizing pure potential. All these forms are not extracted from pure potential. They still completely are one with pure potential. It's seamless. It's seamless. All is already seamless. All is always seamless. All is always seamless. Always. All is always seamless. Always. Always seamless, always. So, in teachings of Jesus, of course, in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, the other voice, he does not, in his return, this is his return to this world, he does not talk about law of attraction. Does not talk about quote unquote the secret, how the law of attraction. No, nothing, no talk about that at all. Where we're getting at is that everything is perfect. Everything already is perfect just as it is. I'm perfectly free. I'm not bound in some universe where I have to figure out how to attract something to me. I am free in the self. I'm already complete. I don't need anything to complete me at all. Pure potentiality is not located somewhere. It's all that is. Always. God is all that is always. So it's a very nasty trap to go into this law of attraction teaching. Very, very nasty trap. It's I want a car. I feel better if I get this car. Wait a minute. That car really looks more attractive. And then what happens is you get hooked on attractiveness. What makes me look attractive to others? How can I feel more attractive? As if you are trying to be God. Really? It's very nasty. You're not realizing your freedom. You're not realizing the freedom of all. It's not just that I am free, that all is free. There's nothing ever left God. There's no separations ever taking place. Look at Ramana Maharshi. Is he spending all his time concentrating? I want a better car. You know? I want a better spouse, a relationship. I want a better house. I want better clothes. I want to be more attractive. No. Okay, not doing that. So it's spiritual materialism, is the law of attraction, is spiritual materialism. And this is an area that Jesus pointed out, that it's difficult for us, for sure. It's difficult. But we have to say this. We have to say this. We have to get used to this, to realizing this. You hold a seminar, and you say, I'm going to teach you all how to get the house you want, you know, how to get the money you want. Oh boy, people would just, you know, flood to you. Just say, yeah, how do I do this? How do I do this? How do I do this? That's not the way at all. Remember, we don't have needs. We don't have problems. It's the attempt to disempower ourselves which gives rise to these needs and supposed needs and problems. But we don't need to make these needs real, try to make them real and then, you know, meet the needs. What we need to do is recognize that we don't have, these needs are not real. So of course people say, well, you can't be a saint because you're not experiencing the needs that we have, so you can't help us. No, a saint helps by helping us realize we don't have any real needs. This is the way to salvation. Not saying we have real needs and fulfilling them, but saying we don't have any real needs at all. Look, reality is inherently need-free, inherently blissful. There's no lack in reality at all. So a saint is not here to help everybody fulfill their needs. It's to turn people away from that false path and encourage them to recognize, ultimately, that what we are, spirit, doesn't have any needs at all. And people argue, well, we're here in the world. No, we're not here in the world. We're dreaming of a world and dreaming of bodies, but spirit is not here in a world at all. There's only pure potential, and playing with pure potential. There isn't any world in the way we're thinking of it. We're not here. There's no point. We're not here. We don't have needs. We're spirit. And in order to get free of this horrible nightmare, we have to keep getting familiar with this message and not arguing about it. People say, well, first solve my needs, make me feel better. Then maybe I'll listen to you. No, what I'm saying is, first, hear the good news, and then you won't feel so desperate about fulfilling your needs. Of course, people put themselves in desperate situations so they know to justify their desperation, so they don't hear the gospel. They say, no, I'm too desperate to hear the gospel. Well, this is something that everyone manufactures for themselves. It's a defense mechanism. Just being here in this world is a defense mechanism, actually. Or just having a body, thinking your body is a defense mechanism against truth. So the whole purpose of a saint is to share the good news so people begin to get familiar with it. See, familiarity is the key. So if people say, I don't have any time to get familiar with it, I'm too desperate, well, this is what they will say. Say, but you can find 5 minutes in your day. I say, no, I don't even have 5 minutes. We can find a minute. No, I don't know. We can find a second then. Just a second is all it takes. Just an instant. And they'll say, no, I don't even have an instant. Well, you do. Everyone does. Eventually you will. And then the good news is there for you to hear. So this franticness of this world, this defense mechanism, this whole world is a defense mechanism. Cosmic corporate culture is simply a defense mechanism that we're using. And then we feel, what's the secret? How we, just familiarity, just hearing this. That is the secret. Getting familiar with this. Oh, yeah, okay. Our problems disappear when we realize, well, except we don't need them anymore. We don't need them. Defenses are very tricky because we keep thinking we're very, very reasonable. No, I just need help in this. And what we're saying is that we're afraid we're getting too close to setting all problems down. So we need help in at least keeping ourselves happy with this world of problems. That's what we say. That's what we want. Again, I've seen that this world can just fade in this beautiful, beautiful atmosphere, clear. Oh, it's just fabulous. It can take its place just like that. And you feel just, you feel perfect. You feel wonderful. You know, ultimately, we say this body, it has all these needs. It does not. It does not. This is where we're mistaken. We can feel perfect with no respect to what's happening in the world at all. As no, whether we have food or shelter or friends or anything, we can feel, our feeling can be perfect, the body can feel perfect, the body can function perfectly. We are projecting all these needs and functionality upon the body, and then so we can claim that there's all these problems and threats to it. We want it to rain here for 6 months. Maybe we'll get it. That's a good start. Yeah. So what's the secret again? Just hearing this, normalizing it, getting used to it, getting familiar with this. Oh, the body doesn't have any needs. Oh, it's all projected upon the body. Just hearing it. Don't go out and act it out. Because we're not ready for that. Because we're not ready for that. No, so we'll prove it. Prove it. No, because I'm saying, the point is to get familiar with it. The purpose is to get familiar with this first, not to go around and prove it to anybody. They say, well, how do we know? How do we know? Inherently we know. Inherently we know this is true. We're just frightened of it. All what we are is inherently known. So there's no need to prove anything. We already know it's true. People say, well, I need you to prove it before I can believe it. In other words, they're saying, I'm too frightened by this. Continuity feels too extreme. So the answer is just say, oh, okay, I'm having an extreme continuity reaction. And drop the demands and the questions and all these reaction formations. Don't let the reaction formation get hold of you. So obviously I'm seeing in everybody in the world is reaction formations to get in the grip of that, and they feel helpless, compulsive. So what you do, let's say you go see a saint. What's the purpose? To get free of the grip of these reaction formations and get a better way of deal, better way to go along the path. And that's the real benefit. As you begin to begin to practice this quietism, this quietness, self-control, self-poise. No, don't struggle with the struggle, full stop in the now of wow. Begin to practice that. And as you begin to practice that, then you tell you these reaction formations, I don't need you. I don't need you anymore. I have something better. This is what happens. This is how you break these bad habits. These bad habits are what stall us out. So any guru, saint, sage, savior, etc., those who can help, they help break these reaction formations, help you get past them. So you say, I don't need this anymore. I have a better way. I can face the backlash consciously. Oh, I have a continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. I don't have any other problem. This is the only problem I have. I'm totally focused on it. And I'm being patient and kind with myself. Thanking myself for stepping on the brake a little bit here. And I'm not struggling with it. And this prevents reaction formation from crystallizing. And so then your progress gets smoothed out and gets more and more deep in progress. So instead of the rain being a deluge, it's just sort of more of a constant state. It's not so bad. Not so much flooding, flooding in your life. And the reaction formations are, of course, basically coalesce because someone had a peak experience or forced it too much. It was not something that just arose because of the practice they've been doing naturally. But they tried to push things too fast. And so, of course, they're afraid when they let go of that reaction formation. This peak experience is going to come back. But no, because you're not forcing it anymore. It doesn't come back. You're not forcing it anymore. It will only come back when the backlash is not too strong. You go this way, quieter, simpler, seemingly slower way, which actually turns out to be faster. You see the story of the tortoise and the hare. The hare is making leaps and then goes to sleep. What happens? Sleep means a reaction formation. Sleeps for a long time. Meanwhile, the tortoise has passed up the hare. It's way further along. And then the hare wakes up. Oh, wait a minute. Oh, okay. It leaps again. Reaction formation. Goes to sleep like that. The tortoise is finished. The hare is still sleeping. Now, a lot of people do this when they're young, because they want to get into a relationship. People, their bodies are so attractive. They go, oh, it's so attractive. And they say, okay, but this relationship doesn't want me to be a monastic, spend my time praying, So we want to have this thrilling physical relationship. We want to get into it. And so I say, well, I want to be enlightened, so I better do it real fast. I better do that so I can get into this other thing. And so try to, force the issue through impetuosity, reaction formation forms. And then that becomes the safety net. I think they need to make to be happy within this cocoon, conceptual cocoon. The seduction, this rose, come on, relationships, come on, you know that's what you want. And it's constantly being broadcast to us in every possible way. Because, of course, we're frightened of our perfection. We're frightened that we're not disempowered at all. So we're trying to see, what we're trying to do in the world is say, well, how much have we been disempowered? Trying to figure that out. And so they think going through enlightenment, they can tell them, you know, how much have we been disempowered, you know? And they say, well, prove that we're perfect, because I don't think it's so, you know? So they want to believe that we have been disempowered, to some extent. And again, there's no reason to prove anything, it's self-evident. So one has to organically realize the self-evidency of it on their path. Not cannot be empirically forced upon anybody through proof. And most people are so frightened they don't even want to take the first step. So they don't want to admit that. So they try to blame the saint or the sage or the savior and the guru. They say, no, you just haven't proved it to me. If you did, I'd just be raring to go, which is nonsense. Because if you're raring to go, you would be tuned into your own self-evidency. And you say, I don't really need, you know, that much proof. It's not, it's whatever it is, fine. Whatever I need will come to me naturally. I'll just keep practicing. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to stop just because some saint doesn't show up in a light, you know, gold ball light. I say, no, whatever needs to show up will show up once the fear levels have been diminished. Once I've evaporated the continuity fear, whatever it needs to show up will show up. And again, the law of attraction has got it reversed. Because what we're looking really to have show up is this feeling of perfection that is not impinged upon at all by body, by world, by anything. We're not trying to say, oh, I feel so terrible, but if I just get the right house, I'll feel better. That's not really the goal. One way or the other. Neither is it to have a lousy house or anything. Yes, it's materiality is not the goal. The goal is to realize good or bad, and good and bad, whatever appearance doesn't affect how I feel. Does not affect how I feel. Does not affect the baseline of feeling of perfection, of freedom, of bliss. Doesn't affect it at all. Whether there's the ground, or we dig a hole in the ground. The pure spaciousness is there equally, whether there's a hole on the ground or not a hole on the ground. So appearance cannot accomplish anything in terms of pure spaciousness or pure potential. It can't. There's nothing to accomplish. Everything is already. Always is perfect right now. Everything is perfect. Always will be. Always has been. Always will be. Always is perfect. Always is perfect. All is always perfect. All is always perfect. Now, reaction formations, we'll try to take notes and try to get this down. I need to be able to get it in a conceptual less defensiveness. So I can hold on to this. Say, no, I have this. I don't need the experience. I have this. I have the words. So try not to take notes. See how you feel. People are probably, those who are used to taking notes, will feel extremely concerned and worried. I might forget this. I might forget what? What they're saying is, experiencing a perfection, they dawn upon me, and I've forgotten the words to make it dissipate. That's what they want. They want to say, wait a minute, where are my words? How is this being caused? I need to know how it's caused so I can sustain it. You know, that's a trick we play on ourselves. Reality doesn't need to be sustained. There's nothing that can stop it from being sustained. So there's no need to sustain itself. So when you have a glimpse of perfection, like I did this morning, you should just say, I don't need to sustain problems in order to experience this. This doesn't need to be sustained. This doesn't have a sustaining problem. That's part of the perfection of it. This doesn't have a problem sustaining itself. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. So instead of practicing the secret of law of attraction, say this instead. There's nothing I need to do to sustain what I am. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. Try this practice. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. Practice this, practice this, practice this. You can be non-specific, but you can make it specific at times too. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. So then when the glimpse arises, we can just say, there's nothing I need to do to sustain this. And you're already used to this feeling. The reason why it seems to disappear is we'd say, well, we jump back, well, how do I sustain this? Well, I need to figure out how. What's causing this? And then we look to nature to think, how is nature causing this? It's not. Nature is not causative, actually. Reality is real. There's no causation sustaining it other than the will of God. So there's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing that needs to be done to sustain this. There's nothing that needs to be done to sustain this. So when we say this, we're going for the real prize. Because even if we use the law of attraction to get a car, we have to sustain what? We have to sustain the insurance on it. We have to sustain the gasoline in it. We have to sustain the washing of the car. We have to sustain the maintenance on it. We have to, you know, sustain, deal with all sorts of issues. But we're experiencing imperfection. There's nothing we need to do to sustain this. So you may see someone in meditation in a Himalayan cave, and maybe they're saying, there's nothing I need to do to sustain this. Are they talking about the world? No. They're talking about perfection. The more we can accept there's nothing that we need to do to sustain perfection, the more easily perfection can dawn on us, and the dawn turn into the day. Everlasting day of perfection. See, we take this problematical dream of nature we have, which everything needs to be battle, fight to sustain everything here, and we just then transfer that onto perfection, thinking, well, great, but how do we sustain it? So whenever we get something nice in this world, immediately we think, oh, this is wonderful. Then we start saying, wait a minute, how do I sustain this? How long is this going to last? You get a brand new computer. How do I keep viruses from infecting it, right? How do I update it? How do I keep, you know, all this, how long is it going to last? How do I keep it uncluttered? How do I keep the speed going? How do I? There's no end to all these concerns we have. Whatever we get, it was a new relationship. Oh, this is wonderful. We're in love. But how do we sustain this love? You see? Immediately. There's this nagging concern, insecurity. Like, well, how do I sustain this? Get a house. Oh, my God. So many problems with sustaining a house. A yard. How do I sustain this yard? I get enough money to help people help me sustain it. But how do I get all that money? I've got to be successful. But how do I? I'm successful. Oh, okay, I'm successful. How do I maintain my success? Okay, oh, I've got retirement money. But how do I hold on to that money? How do I make sure I don't spend too much? How do I maintain? How do I sustain what I want? How do I sustain what I want? What is reality? Which is what we really want? There's no issue sustaining it. It's always there. Nothing that anyone will ever need to do to sustain reality in the slightest bit. Nothing. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. So in listening to any focus on truth, it goes in ways we don't expect, right? And we're like, wow, I didn't expect to arrive here. This is not what I set out for. I was trying to figure out how to sustain my happiness, and now I'm practicing. I don't need to do anything to sustain my happiness. I don't need to do anything to sustain my happiness. This is the key. We're so frantic in trying to figure out how to sustain our happiness that we don't even take one moment to feel happy and realize we don't need to sustain our happiness. There's nothing we need to do to sustain our happiness. Now, the Holy Spirit knows we have, in this world, as long as we're moving a body around, there are basic pragmatic issues. The Holy Spirit knows that. We don't let the Holy Spirit take care of that. Our job is to heal our minds, except heal perception. That's our job. Our job is heal perception. So there's nothing I need to do to sustain healed perception. There's nothing that anyone needs to do to sustain healed perception. There's nothing that anyone needs to do to sustain healed perception. My feet are soaked from walking around checking everything. It's starting to get cold. I better change. So there's nothing I need to do to sustain my happiness. There's nothing I need to do to sustain my perfect happiness. There's nothing that needs to be done ever by anyone to sustain my perfect happiness, to sustain perfect happiness for all. So when you get a glimpse, instead of fixating on it, which is attempt to sustain it, just say, there's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's absolutely nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's absolutely nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's absolutely nothing I need to do to sustain this. This is a super important practice. And of course, the path of salvation is all about practice. That's what it is. So we need to practice. There's nothing I need to do to sustain happiness, my happiness. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. We can just say this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. And the more we say this and accept it, the easier it is for our happiness to dawn upon us. It won't scare us. Because what we're scared of is several things. I'm not used to this. And also we're saying, well, how do I sustain this? Like, oh, this is great, but my gosh, I'm gonna be without it. I gotta figure out how do I protect this. So, and then that, it disappears because there's nothing we need to do to protect it. So then we're immediately looking for what form of happiness we need to protect. And then we're back in nature again. So, in order to experience the supernatural, say, there's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing that anyone needs to do to sustain this. full stop in the now as well. I was starting to think about the problems, potential problems. Now I just got to first get used to this, get familiar with it, so you feel very comfortable with it. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. See, in nature, everything's always changing, right? But our happiness never changes. So there's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nowhere I need to go to sustain this. Nothing I need to do. There's nowhere I need to go to sustain this. There's no one I need to meet to sustain this. There's no experience I need to sustain this. There's no one I need to meet to sustain this. There's nowhere I need to go to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. Nothing has to happen to sustain this. Nothing has to happen to sustain this. This is happening free. This is a happening free happiness. This is a happening free humor, happening free happiness, happening free freedom. A happening free freedom. There's nothing that needs to happen to sustain this. See, we know this rain. We want more, but how can we sustain it? It's going to, tomorrow will be gone. Saturday will be clear. So, but our happiness, there's nothing we need to do to, nothing needs to happen to sustain our happiness. Nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do. Nothing needs to happen to sustain this. Nothing needs to happen to sustain this. There is nothing that needs to happen to sustain this. Nothing needs to happen to sustain this. The more we can get used to this, the more massive amounts of suffering we're saving. We're saving ourselves from so much suffering. So we imagine someone sitting in a cave somewhere and they're saying, there's nothing I need to do. Nothing needs to happen to sustain this. Referring to this, referring to natural, pure happiness of reality, happiness that I am. There's nothing needs to happen to sustain this. Well, they're making, you know, massive progress. They're saving themselves incredible amount of suffering by doing this. There's nowhere I need to go to sustain this. Nothing I need to say to sustain this. Nothing I need to do to sustain this. Nothing I need to think to sustain this. Nothing I need to say to sustain this. There's nothing I need to do to sustain this. There's no effort I need to make to sustain this. Nothing has to happen to sustain this. Just go through that. Just practice. So this is a further step in advancement, very strong step here. We've just advanced to a tremendous extent by getting to this practice. So here it is. Here it is. It's for the shared with the whole world. All right, very great. That's it. There's nothing that needs to happen to sustain this.